thank you so, so, so much for clicking on this video. The fact that you wouldn't sacrifice a few minutes out of your day to consume my content really does mean the world to me. And today we're joined by Psychedillo.
Hey.
Otherwise known as Danny Moshka. And she has her own YouTube channel, and you can discover that by clicking on the link down below. Do you want to tell everyone what you do?
I do cosplay stuff, geek stuff, pretty much everything in between. So, yeah.
And today we're going to be doing some true crime stuff, which is really your bread and butter in comparison to mine.
Definitely.
And we're going to be reviewing a new Netflix series, which is my bread and butter. So this is a perfect combination of the two of us. And today we're going to be talking about the new Netflix series, Crime Sing.
Vanishing at the Cecil Hotel.
So the series is actually a true crime documentary based around the disappearance of Elisa Lam. We're going to talk about her name just now, because that's also something I want to talk about in this documentary. But ultimately, this is an unsolved crime, it looks like, and everyone's trying to discover what happened, how did she disappear, and everyone knows about this infamous elevator footage that you showed me through a BuzzFeed Unsolved video.
Yeah.
And so this is actually a really infamous, well-known case that lots of people are incredibly interested in. And I think just true crime fans in general are incredibly interested in this case.
Yeah, true crime, people who are interested in the unsolved, it falls into both categories. It's probably one of the greatest unsolved mysteries of, I would say, our 21st century.
Yeah, because it's a very recent case. If I'm not mistaken, it's 2013.
Yeah, 2013.
Which is very recent, because I just ended up reviewing the Night Stalker series. Mm-hmm. And they actually talk about Richard Ramirez in this series, because he also went to the Cecil Hotel. And that was very, very interesting for me. But he was at his height in the 80s.
Yeah, I was in the 80s.
So the fact that this Cecil Hotel, which I talk about a lot in the series, has been a hotspot for crime, for suicide,
murder.
All of the dodgy stuff, yeah. But ultimately, this is a very dodgy place where a ton of bad stuff happened. And so it kind of makes sense that this incredibly infamous unsolved case would take place in this incredibly
historic
location. So let's actually talk about the series and its production value. I have mixed feelings about it. I don't know about you.
Netflix in general is pretty good with their true crime shows and their documentaries. Like, as a person who kind of always delves deep into true crime, I say that their documentaries are so well done. They kind of look at it from almost every aspect. But I wouldn't consider this to be one of their best documentaries.
Hmm.
It's very slow paced.
I remember I told you that in like the very first episode.
Yeah, I was like,
I have a massive issue with the pacing of the series. Not just the pacing, but its entire storytelling dynamic. They do not follow a chronological order at all. They jump from the 80s to the early 2000s to the present day and back, and it really makes it difficult for you to come to your own conclusions, because they give you evidence in such a weird order.
Yeah, they focus on sensationalism rather than
telling the story in a satisfactory way.
Yeah, or a way that, for people who don't know the case, it might be slightly harder to follow, because they jump from one time period to a certain event, then they go back and then they say, oh no, wait, actually that didn't happen.
Mm. No, that's a good way of putting it, because all I knew about this case was the BuzzFeed video that you had sent to me. And so I at least had a basic understanding of what happened. But they literally introduced this series with the assumption that everybody knows this story. Unlike the Night Stalker series I've already mentioned, that was in chronological order. They break down everything in a nice, bite-sized way. Like, they didn't spend a lot of time in all the cases, but they explain them well enough that you, as someone who didn't understand who Richard Ramirez was, would be able to understand everything that happened. And I really feel like they didn't grasp that effectively in this series.
Yeah, I would say it's a show that you have to really watch, and you can't kind of be walking around and popping in, because of the way everything is so scattered. If you don't catch something at the beginning of the show, you don't know where you are later in the show.
Yeah, because of the way they jump around, if you miss one thing earlier on, It's gone. Yeah. I do also feel like this series is incredibly bloated. It's only 4 episodes long. Each one is about an hour long. So you can unpack a lot, but they unpack so much unnecessary stuff that had nothing to do with the story at all, just for the points, as you mentioned, of sensationalism.
Yeah.
So that was a little bit disappointing. Talking about something else that was very disappointing is the fact that they just never got the names of the hotel or Eliza consistent.
Yeah.
Because for the hotel, they kept saying Cecil or Cecil.
Yeah.
And you want to talk about the name?
For Elisa, I didn't actually know what her name was for a long time, purely because at the start they started calling her Elisa, then it was Eliza, then it was Elisa, then it was, like, everyone pronounced it a different way. So, like, as maybe someone who's a South African and we don't use American pronunciation, I don't actually know how I was supposed to pronounce her name throughout the entire
show.
And
I think also what made that a little bit more difficult as well is because the biggest aspect I enjoyed the most of the series is their incorporation of YouTubers. Because I thought that was really, really cool. I mean, we saw
Ryan Vigar from BuzzFeed and Soul.
So that was cool, for especially for you.
Yeah.
And I was at least like, oh, there's someone that I know because I'm not into true crime as much as you are, or the unsolved,
we'll
or the
there.
Supernatural as much as you
we'll
are.
Get there.
But it was cool to see a face that I recognized. It was cool to see I'm very passionate about communities on YouTube. That is something that I love. And to see an entire YouTube community come together to discuss a topic like this for me was just really cool to see in a real world sense. So that was cool for me. But I think we also got to see the negatives of that.
Yeah.
Because there were so many of these internet sleuths that just jump to how they're feeling, and they believe that they have the right to do whatever they want, which is something I feel we all do at times if it's something we're incredibly passionate about.
It was a good view of the good and the bad of kind of internet people getting together and trying to solve a mystery. Because if you look back at one of Netflix's other releases, which is Don't F with Cats, that focuses a lot on internet sleuths and how they actually did help the case in catching Luca Magnotta, if I'm not mistaken his name was. And they only showed the good aspects of that. So this was a more realistic view on how it can be both a helpful thing, but also detrimental to people that might be caught in the crossfire of people throwing accusations, making assumptions.
Because we both got quite annoyed at the internet sleuths, because in the third and fourth episode, there's this one singer that was accused for murdering Elisa Lam. And he wasn't even in the same country at the same time.
It was all purely coincidental.
Purely coincidental, because he happened to be at the same hotel a year earlier. And this guy even tried to take his own life. And he talks about, like, even to this day, he can't continue to make music because it's not the same. Like, they've ruined his passion for something he had nothing to do with. So that was probably the most interesting section of the entire documentary for me, is to see how it impacted somebody's life who actually had nothing to do with the case until somebody started to wrongly accuse him. That was really interesting from my point of view.
For me, one of the most interesting parts of that was also the views on mental health that they put forward, because obviously Elisa Lam, still not sure how to pronounce it, she was known to have been on medication for her bipolar disorder, her depression, and as someone who also struggles with mental health, it was interesting how they navigated those waters and how they kind of explained that yes, her mental disorders could have, or her mental illness could have contributed to what happened, but they didn't necessarily paint it in a completely negative light. They didn't say, are all people with bipolar disorder act a certain way? They were very considerate of a
community.
And sensitive around that topic, which I really appreciated. Mm. There was no stigma attached to things.
So if we're going to continue this conversation about using YouTubers in the documentary, one thing that, like, really tilted me was the fact that they never actually gave the YouTubers proper credits when they were... They would, like, show the YouTube screen and the YouTube HUD or whatever, and they'd show the videos, but the titles weren't actually the correct names. They had the creators' names, and then they had a false name for the video. And I thought that was very scummy. If you're going to be using somebody else's content that they filmed, and I understand they probably did get written permission to use everything, and they probably did approach YouTube and say, hey, can we use your stuff? And they would have had to say yes if it was going to be in the documentary. But if people are going to be consuming your content, would you not want to shout out the YouTubers correctly?
Yeah, they pretty much just copied and pasted the Cecil Hotel on all of the videos. And it just...
When we tried to find some of their videos, we couldn't find the originals because just the titles were all out of whack.
And those if you search the creator's name and let's say the Cecil Hotel, at some point, it is likely that it was in the actual title, but it goes so far back, all the way back to 2013, that it's almost impossible to find these people's videos because you don't have the actual title of it.
Yeah.
And that was a bit disappointing.
Yeah, I just think if you're going to be using somebody else to tell your narrative, you'd want to be able to make it easier for the consumer to find out more about what they're watching. Mm-hmm. And when we were trying to find their original YouTube videos, it became kind of a nightmare.
Yeah.
And if it's especially if it's something like true crime like this, where you want to do your own research afterwards, you want to have all of the facts there available for you so you can watch it. Another thing that annoyed me, talking about doing your own research, in episode 2, I believe it was, or episode 3, they mentioned they have video footage of Eliza taking a box from someone. And they're like, we have this video footage and you could see this happening. And then they straight up just didn't show you the video footage. Like that earlier in the episode, in the series, throughout the whole series, they're constantly showing the elevator footage.
Mm.
But they refuse to show this interaction. And I have no idea why. But all it did is made me skeptical that the events ever happened.
Yeah, they really, really pushed that this video captured two men handing a box to her. And the only reason I can think that they omitted it is to protect the two men's identities. But the thing is, you could have still blocked their faces.
Just blur their faces.
People do it all the time. It's super easy.
So all it made me go is, okay, well, because they always talk about conspiracies in the series as well. And that just makes me go, that's likely now.
Yeah.
Because why the hell won't you show us the video footage? That's the easiest way to lie. Saying you have evidence and then not showing the evidence. That's just my... I'm not saying there is a giant conspiracy, but I'm just saying if there was one, that is probably the most blatant proof of it.
It just feels like it discredits evidence or information, and it feels disappointing that this many years down the line, there's still bits of information that are being withheld from the public or, you know, pushed aside. Mm. And I just wish if they kept mentioning the CCTV footage, they had just even showed like a second
of it.
Just
a second of it, just so we know it actually
exists.
Just
a screen cap, actually. Yeah.
And then a few other things. I think it was really cool at the end. They talk about the legacy that Eliza's left. And I'm just a big fan of legacy. What legacy do you leave behind? And she... she unwillingly left an entire legacy. And whether that legacy has been romanticized or not is open for interpretation. Because some of those people, in my opinion, were very creepy in the way they looked up to Eliza. But they did it in a very, I don't want to seem like offensive, but it didn't seem like in a wholesome way.
Well, it felt borderline stalkerish if it is possible to stalk a deceased person. It felt like an extremely personal way, in a way that it maybe is not acceptable.
No, I agree with you. Because there was this one guy in the entire documentary, every time he was on screen, we were like, this doesn't feel right. Every time he was on screen, we were just like, every time he was on screen, we both just looked at each other and we were like, there's something really awkward about the way he perceives Eliza and this entire case. It didn't feel... I didn't feel comfortable watching him talk.
It is a side effect of most of the true crime... Not most of them, but the true crime community does get very involved in the personal lives of things. And some people just take it a step that gets almost too far because... And it's maybe not those people's fault. Maybe they just see some of themselves in that person. But people have the tendency to kind of take it to a point that it may be uncomfortable for the family. It may be uncomfortable for people that are not as ingrained.
Or even have an existing relationship with the person that actually unfortunately passed away. Whether you like it or not, you just know the person from newspaper clippings. You never had a personal one-on-one relationship with that person.
Yeah, and it's just... We can actually point this out because there were so many YouTubers that had followed the case from like the moment the police posted the elevator footage. So multiple people had been following the case for years, but not all of them had that creepy level of obsessiveness.
Yeah.
So I feel like some people could have turned it down for the Netflix show, but...
But guys, ultimately at the end of the day, I think it was enjoyable.
Yeah.
I learned a hell of a lot from this documentary. A lot more than we did from that one, like, 20-minute BuzzFeed video.
Hey. That was like 7 minutes, and it was still good. Don't just my voice.
No, they did a good job, but it's... They, of course, with the amount of time and the budget they had
resources.
With this document and the resources, they were able to tell a much more comprehensive and all-encompassing story. So if you are a fan of this case, definitely check out the series.
Yeah. As someone who's been involved in the true crime community and has... followed cases like this for years, I know I learned a lot from the case that I didn't know prior. So people who are new to this kind of thing, people who are like old in the community, it's still a worthwhile watch. It was decently slow, but it was definitely worthwhile. Netflix continues to just nail it when it comes to documentaries, I would say.
Cool. But guys, thank you so much for watching this video. You guys are the best. You're awesome. Please subscribe to my channel. Then jump across to her channel and subscribe to her as well. That would be so freaking cool. But guys, thank you so much for watching this video. You're awesome. You're the best. And we hope to see you again in another video.
Bye.